tried to get there, didn't
you? Yeah, I did the 100 Club, the punk festival. Siouxsie and the Banshees. I didn't have time to think about it. It just happened, and I went on the stage without thinking about it.
We got away with it and built a long career on that one moment. But it was nothing to do with, like, any idiot can do it, because any idiot can't do it.
The idea to do it was to play, to bore the pants off everyone, so they'd chuck us off.
They are punk rockers. The new craze, they tell me. They're heroes, not the nice, clean Rolling Stones. You see, they are as drunk as I am. They are clean by comparison. They are a group called the Sex Pistols.
I don't know if he noticed, if Bill Grundy noticed the swearing to start with.
What was the rude word?
Shit.
Was it really? Good heavens, you frightened me to
death. All right. So
what about you girls behind?
Right, you're dead, isn't he?
Are you,
With your granddad.
Are you worried, or are you just enjoying yourself?
Enjoying myself.
Are you?
Yeah.
That's what I thought you were doing.
I always wanted to meet you.
Did you really?
Yeah.
Young, you need to be part of the flock, I think, or you feel you do. Probably around the time of 16 or 17, and that need became kind of defiant.
Don't forget, there was a Chinese restaurant in Chislehurst called the Hong Kong Garden. Me and my friend were really upset that we used to go there, and like, occasionally when the skinheads would turn up, it would really turn really ugly.
Siouxsie's role was to be the kind of figurehead and something that you could actually aspire to.
On it, the production, everything, the photography for the front, the layout, everything, perfect. There we are, here's a tombstone.
We couldn't write new songs fast enough because we weren't getting on well enough. It wasn't out-and-out fighting, but it wasn't a very creative atmosphere either. I had three or four songs that could have gone on Join Hands, but we just couldn't get them together. Watch the muscles twitch for a brand new swing. Stavro was not a joy to work with, and Neil's interfered in the production and started to try and get me to do things that I did not do naturally.
That was the beginning of the rift between me and Siouxsie and John and Kenny, because John and Kenny just couldn't bear it.
He didn't like our music for a start. He was so laid back. Everything took for ages to get done. And he just didn't give a shit.
We walked into the record shop and they were playing Join Hands. John immediately took it off and put the Slits album on. And we started signing a few things. And then Polydor basically made the mistake of not actually supplying the shop with enough records. So Neil's had a box of promo albums in the back of the van.
And they were stamped with gold, not for resale. So I presumed that we were just going to hand a few out.
John Mackay started giving them away. And I think that's when Siouxsie clocked him.
I stood there for a second and then looked at Kenny. Kenny looked at me and we just walked straight out.
We went straight to soundcheck, fully expecting to see them there. And, they didn't show and they didn't show again.
Fucking flushed everything down the toilet, basically. And I just thought it's such a shitty thing to do to anyone, let alone somebody you'd practically live with for 2 years. It was within about 2 weeks of rehearsals, we went back on the road and picked up the Join Hands tour. But at the end of the rehearsal, I kind of thought, well, the budget was really good. It kind of didn't really piss me off at all.
That was the first song that we wrote with John McGeoch. Over the years, he's my favourite Banshee guitarist.
I think Happy House was where I really kind of, you know, started to say something about where I felt like, you know, somewhere between Keith Moon and Ginger Baker and me.
I don't carry anything for any females, and I hate being called the best female singer.
Christine Sizemore, who was a woman who had 22 personalities. And she literally had personalities where one, she was blind, another one where she only wore purple, and she would just, like, completely forget the other personas and just be... And one character, she was just actually blind. Very fascinating.
I saw McGeoch play with Magazine on TV and I thought that was it, we had to steal him. And it was the first of many thefts.
Nils Stevenson, who was the manager at the time, reckoned he'd coated me with limousines and champagne and stuff like that. Well, he did, but that wasn't why I joined the Banshees.
Immediately there was a kind of, you know, a lighter atmosphere in the whole proceedings because of, They were just different characters. Going to be either, you know, one of the punk survivors, goth veterans. You know.
The music around the time of Juju, you could say, pretty much invented the genre. I don't think that's too preposterous a claim.
I remember feeling, oh my God, what have I done?
Spent the whole year touring, and particularly in Europe and America, the touring was very, the circumstances were really tough. And I think it just took its toll on him more than anybody else, really. So he kind of had to be rested.
Pressures were about putting up an outstanding performance every night. It was, in a sense, it was the pursuit of excellence, really.
A few shows had started to fuck up, and finally, the show we were doing, he was playing another song, you know, Melt during Happy House, and I mean, literally, and didn't know.
I just played a terrible gig. And, you know, we flew home and that was it.
I'd been overworking and it was in a tour of Scandinavia and I was very ill. I was like coughing up blood and I couldn't talk. And I saw a specialist in Lund and he said, kaput, finished. Unless you sing like Sheena Easton, you will never have a voice again.
We'd already recorded some tracks for A Kiss in the Dream House. We had things to work on while Susie was taking a rest.
Then in steps Robert Smith.
He knew all the songs. You know, there was only one person who knew them better was McGeoch. And it was just obvious. And he basically put The Cure on hold. So it suited him to come on board the Banshees again and ride the gravy train to weirdness. In some strange way, the fact that Robert was playing with the Banshees as well was kind of divorcing him from the rest of his band. I was there at one meeting with him and Chris Parry, where he explained quite eloquently why he wanted to go and play with the Banshees for a second time. He said, well, I played with you last time, but we didn't record, so this time we've got to make a record together. It was always the notion that he would have to get back to work, you know, to his real life.
But I think Chris was very nervous that he was going to go off and leave The Cure behind and join the Banshees permanently. So there was this tug of war going on, which manifested itself more during the recording of the Banshees album Hyena in '84 that we did with Robert.
The music has changed quite naturally owing to the departure of various musicians, mainly guitarists. It was special playing the Royal Albert Hall. It's getting increasingly difficult to play in London without playing the Hammersmith Palais or the Hammersmith Odeon.
We were in the studio for about 2.5-3 months altogether. Then we did the Albert Hall and the video for that. And of course, Robert was disappearing every now and then, which was only a minor problem, but it did. Until he had done all his guitar, it was a bit of a stumbling block.
Every album, we always and make sure that we get that album out of our system and that we don't want to ever do a part one, part two, part three of one thing.
Robert was sort of like a little brother to Severin. You know, Severin was kind of dressing him up and showing how to wear shades and letting him borrow his, you know, white jacket and jewellery, you know, his crucifixes and that.
Kind of in the back of my mind, I knew he would never kind of give up The Cure because he had too much of a personal vision to be subsumed into another band, particularly with such a strong front person as Siouxsie.
To qualify being called a producer, a good producer is should only be as good as the group is. And it should work both ways. To be honest, Robert is not working with us, and he's not working full stop. He's gone over the edge. We've always been fascinated with songs off the screen being scored into string music, classical music. We've used strings a few years before. We actually took them out live, a trio of string players.
Whilst on tour in Italy, and we were going south through to Taranto, and the opportunity whilst travelling arose that we could go visit Pompeii. So of course he went, and I don't know, the impression was so powerful and like culminating in seeing the petrified bodies. Cities in Dust happened because it had a strong effect on me, seeing the remains of the petrified bodies still caught in time as a huge body print in the lava. Represents in a way a kind of a rejection of a stereotype, the blonde, dumb cuteness that is sought after by most youth, especially female.
I think the main thing that differentiates our songs from other people is the fact that we are sort of obsessed with things, or, you know, overly interested in a lot of subjects, whereas most people tend to sort of not be too interested in anything.
During a tour of Britain, I managed to dislocate the knee, and so when we finished the tour and I just got out of plaster, we were able to finish the album with an engineer.
It was one of those inspired leaps and twists, and I landed badly on the monitor wires.
We've got an album coming out in February called Through the Looking Glass. We thought we'd have some fun and pick our 10 least favourite songs and butcher them. If your memory serves you well, We always said, well, we haven't never set ourselves out to be a punk band, or a funk band, a rock band, a jazz band. We never limited ourselves that way, and the groups that did caught that kind of pigeonholing didn't last, or they become laughable pantomime acts.
We've had to firstly reinvent the group a lot of times. And most of these personnel changes have been enforced upon us as opposed to us throwing out somebody because they weren't working properly.
It's not unusual that we cover songs. I mean, from the first album, Helter Skelter was on it. It's not what you do, it's how you do it. I think partly why we've lasted for 10 years is pure spite. I think if you think about being a better adversary than your enemies, I think that keeps you going. The Stepford Wives films, I just think everyone's becoming so modelled to the perfect ideal of what either a woman or a man should be like, and it really disgusts me, and you know? Peekaboo's really just a reaction against that kind of control that I think is coming through in the media. It's an outtake of something. It's brass backwards, and it's really made it into a tape loop. We've been keeping away from rehearsal rooms, London, touring and everything, to write Peepshow.
I went to a place in Ardingly, Sussex. Mm-hmm. An old country house called Berry House,
mm-hmm.
And we took about 2 months.
It was very soon after the storm that happened in October, so the countryside took on a very strange sort of destroyed landscape with all these giant trees that had stood for hundreds of years just lying sort of dead in fields and whatever. I certainly am more inspired by the film goddesses, the screen goddesses, and the very strong women of the 30s. You was the perfect sort of story to use for the song. It was had some of the lyrics for it that were sort of based around, I don't know, the frailty of always aiming at something that glitters and fame, fortune, and basing your whole life around that. And everyone thought she was a second-rate Marilyn Monroe or something, but she was really very powerful, very in control of herself, albeit she had that one direction of how she wanted to be perceived. Banshees last month, they kept losing guitarists. So we kind of had to slightly alter things and readapt.
Looking back, it's like having a moving photo album when you see like old videos. It just seems like different people, totally different people. And the further you get away from your memories of the actual recording and the gigs you did at the time, it just becomes a bit of a blur.
I think MTV is rife with sexuality in a certain way that I find highly offensive, but I would never censor it. And I think the fact that it's genders of the same sex doing something that I think is very tender, I'm very surprised that anyone would be offended by it.
What a perfect project for the Banshees to get. I mean, I'm mad about cats, you know. I'm just obsessed with anything feline. So when we got approached, it was actually by Tim Burton. It wasn't a company thing. It was actually Tim Burton that requested that we do the song for the film.
And then we got a message at Tim Burton and would really like us to do a song for a scene in the Batman film. I nearly said, no, I'm not interested.
Superstition was in 91. We finished in 91 and we did the Lollapalooza tour. When it first started, it was an idea by the lead singer of Jane's Addiction at the time. They've since disbanded, Harry Farrell, and a promoter of his. They'd seen Reading and there was nothing like that in America. Help me, save me from it, hold me, help me.
Baby was probably the last song we wrote in the writing period with John Cale. It was like a thing that came about almost as we were like packing up the gear and leaving the room.
The music's just evolved and we just gathered more experiences. Obviously, we're the same people, so there's kind of the same driving force, but there's more of a diversity in expressing that intensity. Working with John Cale was a unique experience in that he was someone that had much more of a history than we did, didn't feel intimidated by us.
A reaction to the last album, we recorded it in a completely different, practically live way.
You know, it's, you know, if you take the word the rapture, it's the rapture from the eyes of, through the eyes of a child, maybe. And it's got that innocence and kind of, you know, stupidness about it.
The last album was the rapture, and there was a lot of... It was like, that was hard work, getting the thing organized.
Me and Budgie would be going through things with Martin and John, working things out. You know, Severin would be sulking in his room.
And I think that's kind of, to me, was that it was, I suppose, the certainly the first warning sign, if you like. You know, that this is not working the way it used to be.
You know, for God's sake, are we bloody Pink Floyd, or all of a sudden, you know, that, you know, shall we reconvene in 1995?
Susie had done another one of her interviews for Time Out where she basically said she wouldn't piss on Polydor if it was on fire.
I just felt everybody was wearing blinkers and I was sick of it, and I just said, that's it.
Literally, I was supposed to just be in a band for 15 minutes, and that was it. I just wanted to see what it felt like, and I got hooked.
I think when anything lasts as long as the Banshees did, I think there's always an element of carrying other people's baggage of what they think you are, what you're about, and the media and misinformation that gets passed down and down and down over the years. It just ends up into some kind of ridiculous cartoon. Well, since we decided to stop the band 7 years ago, we've all been doing our own careers, but we're all really aware that our legacy needed looking after. We probably hadn't listened to our old stuff for like 20 years or so.
We spent the best part of 7 years rowing with Polydor. Bah!
I really want to compile a selection of B-sides, and it would have to be a 4-album set or something, I don't know.
Being able to look people in the eye and say, fuck you, I don't care what you think, I'm doing what I want to do. To have that to hold on to is really important to move forward.
Grand plans, and to make records like The Scream, to make records that had never been made before. We wanted to be the best band in the world.
A nice girl from Chislehurst, a very disenchanted girl from the suburbs, basically.